And the next talk is by Dima Levkov. Yeah, so the title is Instability of Rotating Bose Stars. Go on.
Okay, so thank you, Peter and Igor, for inviting me to give a talk. And I am going to talk about the about the same axion stars as Joshua told you, but about rotating ones. Okay, but the possibility to add rotation to the Bose stars. So this talk is based on our paper with Anton Dmitriev, Alexander Panin, Katya Pushnaya, and Igor Tkachev. The message to take home from this talk is as follows. We expect that all compact objects in the universe are held together, compact and stable objects, they are held together by strong forces, and therefore we can add a little bit of rotation to them. But the Bose stars is an exception from this rule. Actually, they cannot rotate at all. And that's what I'm going to tell you. And our no-go theorem about the non-rotating Bose stars is valid if the self-interaction of axions making these stars is either absent or negative, like in usual models. Okay, so like Joshua, I will consider the light bosonic dark matter, which has masses of particles somewhere between 10 to the minus 22 electron volts and 10 to the 2 electron volts. And this case is very interesting because if you take the estimate the occupation number of this dark matter, say in any dwarf galaxy, you will obtain that the occupation number, the number density divided by space phase space volume, is much larger than one. And this means that this dark matter in this mass region can be described by classical field. And here is the classical field equation, just the Lambert equation with mass term and self-interaction lambda 5 to the cube. Okay, solving this equation, you can describe dark matter and you can obtain a rich wave phenomena. And just another simplification is a non-relativistic approximations that Joshua was discussing. In this approximation, you just expand in velocity and you trade your relativistic field phi to the non-relativistic complex field psi, and this complex field satisfies basically a Schrodinger equation, Schrodinger type of equation, if the self-interaction of the condensate is present, then this equation is non-linear Schrodinger equation, and also it interacts with the Newtonian potential U, which satisfies a Poisson equation. So this is a coupled system of two equations, Gross-Pitayevsky's Poisson system, which can be solved to describe any light dark matter, and all rich wave phenomena are universally described by these two equations. As previous speakers told you, there are many motivated models, several motivated models with light bosonic particles. And in all these models, the particles generically appear as pseudonymbu Goldstone bosons. Two important examples are QCD axions and string axions. In QCD axion case, the masses of dark matter particles, like something like 10 to the minus 5 or 10 to the minus 3 electron volts, depending what simulations do you trust. In string axions, the most interesting case is when the particle mass is super small. In this case, we are talking about fuzzy dark matter. So it is traditional that the self-coupling is negative for QCD axions, which is valid for all simple models of QCD axions. And self-coupling is usually negligible, this is traditional for string axions. And sometimes people consider negative coupling, which corresponds again to attraction. These cases, they are, the axions with negative coupling, this is exactly the case of where our no-go theorem about rotation is valid. And I am going to discuss the same axion stars or Bézier stars that Joshua was talking about. And these are just the solitonic solutions of the equations that I showed you. So in this solution, psi is the wave function of the lowest level in the gravitational field U of R. So on the other hand, the same psi, modulus psi squared, is a density of axions. It creates a potential for itself. So it's self-consistent solution of the two equations where the axions sit in their own potential well, and they occupy the lowest energy. And actually, the axionic field, it oscillates with frequency equal to the binding energy omega s of their level. Okay. And we obtain this family of configurations, which are you can characterize them with mass. Okay, so this is one parametric family. From the physical viewpoint, this is just a drop of Bose-Einstein condensate, which is held by its own self-gravity. So that's why it is spherical. This star actually has been observed to be formed in simulations in two magistral models of fuzzy dark matter. James Niemeyer showed you the results that in every dwarf galaxy during structure formations there appears a solitonic core, giant solitonic Bézier star, okay, of mass of 10 to the 8 solar masses or larger. The case of QCD axions, all the universe is packed with very small gravitational bound systems, the mini clusters, and in the center of each mini cluster there should appear a Bézier star. So the Bézier stars generically they grow by Bose-Einstein condensation, but there was a prediction that this growth should stop beyond certain mass, and it was confirmed by simulations by Jens Niemeyer's group. And actually, this is also a very interesting and mysterious process. And as Joshua previewed, he told about the Bézier nova, and this is a very interesting process if the mass of the Bézier star is large, and if the particles self-interact inside this Bézier star attractively. So in the case of attractive self-interaction, mass of a Bézier star cannot exceed certain critical mass. If it exceeds, the Bézier star with large mass starts to squeeze and it collapses into streams of relativistic axions. On the other hand, if the axions interact with photons, then mass then can appear a parametric radio emission. So the star can start glowing in the radio. And this happens if mass is larger than some other critical mass. So Bézier nova is generically not super good process because you generically cannot easily detect it. And radio emission is generically a good process that you can generically detect. So if the critical mass with respect to Bézier nova is smaller than the critical mass with respect to radio explosion, then then radio explosion do not happen at all. And this is a very sad scenario where you do not expect some flashes, radio flashes on the sky. There was a proposal to remedy this. And proposal involves assumption that some Bézier stars rotate. Okay, if they rotate, then their centrifugal barrier can fight the Bézier nova. It can find the squeeze. It is harder to squeeze the rotating body. If they prevent Bézier nova or somehow fight the Bézier nova, then probably radio explosions of rotating Bézier stars can be still seen on the sky. And so the question is whether the Bézier stars can rotate. So Bose stars can include Bose-Einstein condensate, which is in rotation of Bose-Einstein condensation is has been studied for like half a century. It's already in textbooks. And in textbooks, it is said that the velocity of Bose-Einstein condensate is gradient of the argument of the wave function, a total gradient. And the rotor of this velocity equals to zero. This means that this velocity field is irrotational. So it is irrotational everywhere where the phase of the wave function is defined. And this happen, so in all region except for the line where psi equals to zero. If psi vanishes, then it's its phase is not defined. And in this case, the rotor can have a non-zero value. So generically, the Bose-Einstein condensate without zeros, of the wave function, so-called vortices, it cannot rotate. It has an irrotational velocity field. But at each zero of the first order, each vortex line of the with zero of psi of the first order introduces one quantum of rotation to the condensate. And if the psi has zero of the Lth order, where L is here, it adds L quantum of rotation. So angular momentum of Bose-Einstein condensate, it quantizes, and it quantizes with the number of vortices, the lines, the holes in the condensate, the lines where the density equals to zero. In the case of Bose stars, we should drill a hole psi equals to zero through the condensate to make it rotating, and this costs energy. So so this suggests an axially symmetric ansatz. So we take a spherical star and we drill a hole, vertical hole through it. So we obtain something like a donut, right? The sphere with a hole. And this suggests an axially symmetric ansatz where psi equals to some function of two axial coordinates R and Z. It has the Z component of the angular momentum, namely depends on angle as e to the I alpha. And the gravitational field is just axially symmetric. So you just substitute all of this into the equations and solve them numerically. And what you get, so you can actually substitute it into the expression for the angular momentum. And you will learn that angular momentum in this case equals to mass over mass of particles times the L, the integer number. So you can substitute this ansatz into the equations, solve them numerically, and that's what you get. This is a numerical solution. The left panel explains is the vertical section of the solution. And the horizontal section is on the right panel. And you see that it indeed has a donut form. And there is indeed a two-parametric family of solutions. So we have two codes. One of them gives the axially symmetric solutions. It works in the axial coordinates. And another code finds this solution in three dimensions. So we can obtain also the Bose stars in three dimensions, and they also have axially symmetric form. The question, there are actually solutions which describe rotating stars. Of course, they were known before our paper, and the real question is whether they are stable. So we take some elementary Bose star with L equals to one. I forgot to say that from the physical viewpoint, this is the same Bose-Einstein condensate as before, only all the particles sit on the level with a given angular Z component of the angular momentum, okay? So they sit in their own potential well, but on the excited level with angular momentum L. Here is the check of the stability. And Yeah, so it's simple. Let us add a perturbation to the Bessel star and then evolve it with three-dimensional code. And this tune, it shows the donut form Bessel star, which is, yeah, so it looks in a strange angle, but yeah, so we evolve it in time. So evolution already starts. This object's first state put, but then see it decayed into the two objects, and then one of the two objects gets disrupted, and another persists. And what you get in the final state is some yeah. So you assume that this is a rotating object, but it is not. Look, this is a spherical Bessel star surrounded by a rotating cloud of debris of axions, axionic waves. So this is a Saturn-like configuration, and therefore this shows, this suggests strongly that the rotating Bessel stars are unstable. So why are they as unstable? Here's the slide explaining our instability mechanism and actually explaining how the no-go theorem can be proved. Actually, you can formally prove that these objects are unstable, despite the fact that you cannot find them analytically. Okay, so let us fix the potential and set the self-coupling equal to zero. So all particles sit on the level with angular momentum L of the potential. You can take part of these particles and transfer them to the ground state of the potential with zero angular momentum. And this will certainly decrease the energy. But this process is not allowed, right? Because you will violate angular momentum conservation with this process. What you do is you simultaneously transfer a lot of particles to the ground state, and simultaneously you take only one particle and transfer it to the highly excited state with huge angular momentum. Now, all highly excited states are piled up near omega equals to zero, near energy equals level equals to zero, like in hydrogen atom, because this is a Bessel star, 1 over R gravitational potential. And transferring one particle to the highly excited state, you just pay the energy omega s, where omega is a binding energy of this particle, one particle. But if you transfer many particles to the ground state, you pay, you get energy, you get energy equals to energy difference times the number of particles. So you can write formally the angular momentum conservation to require that this transfer of some particles downstairs and some particles upstairs, this process, it conserve to ensure that this process conserves angular momentum. But then you you can check that the energy in this process is actually decreases, okay? So there is a the method to decrease energy by transferring particles. This can be, this argument can be made into the no-go theorem. In this no-go theorem, you can consider dynamical gravitational potential and self-coupling, zero self-coupling or negative self-coupling. And in this proof, you just add to the Bessel star configuration a ground state times some amplitude plus some highly excited state with large angular momentum times some small number. You ensure that the angular momentum, total angular momentum of this configuration equals to total angular momentum of the previous configuration, and you write a chain of inequalities, and you prove that in this process where particles go down and just a few particles go up, you decrease the energy. So the potential energy of the Bessel star in the configuration space look like this. There are any rotating Bessel star sits on the top of this potential. And the only requirement is that the self-coupling of particles is a zero or negative. So we expect that the in the background of the stars, the linear modes, they grow exponentially. And the question is, what is the lifetime of these objects? The next question, right? So let us calculate the lifetime of these objects. So let me describe first the numerical method, how to do that. second, the analytical method. Somehow, this numerical method is very simple. So you saw that we can solve the evolution equations for the potential for the star. Okay, what we can do? We can do the following. Suppose we consider U equals to configuration equals to Bessel star configuration plus some linear perturbation, and you substitute this ansatz into not ansatz this expansion into the equations, and you linearize with respect to perturbation, and this gives you dynamical equations for perturbations, and the same code that can solve nonlinear equations, it can just solve the dynamical equations for perturbations, and you can find out, solving these equations in time, you can find out the fastest growing mode. Just one remark, when you substitute all of this into the equations, you find, suddenly discover that the equations do not couple all modes of perturbations, all perturbations to each other. They just couple perturbations with angular momentum L plus delta L and L minus delta L. So the process is like I described in the previous transparency, but some particles go down by angular momentum delta L, decrease the angular momentum by delta L, and some particles should go up, increasing the angular momentum by delta L. This is the dominant process. Here's the solution, and it is written, it is plotted on this plot. This plot describes the norm, the logarithm of norm of perturbation as a function of time. And different graphs correspond to different modes with different delta L, with different angular momentum transfer. And you see that most of the graphs, they grow exponentially, red, green, and blue. And the fastest mode corresponds to angular momentum transfer equals to one. So one minus one, one plus one. The inclination of this graph gives you the exponent of growth. And that's how we can calculate, we actually have lifetimes of all Bessel stars with reasonably small L, between L equals to 1 and L equals to 20. Okay, but actually, in the case of fast rotating Bessel stars, you can find everything analytically. And this transparency explains how to do that. It is very simple. You expect that the faster the Bessel star rotates, the larger its size, because the larger is the centrifugal barriers and it makes the star larger. You can estimate the dependence of this radius on L, on angular momentum of this Bessel star, and radius is proportional to L squared. On the other hand, you can estimate the size of the wave function of bosons inside this Bessel star. Just estimate the kinetic energy, and 1 over p is the size of the wave function. And this size is of order of L. In a nutshell, this means that the fast rotating Bessel star is not just a torus. This is a thin ring with a large radius and small thickness. Of course, it's easy to find the profile of this ring. Look, so since the curvature radius of the ring is so large, the curvature radius of this ring is not important. So this ring is equivalent actually to the cylinder of the Bose-Einstein condensate. Okay, so it's natural now that the profile of this Bose-Einstein condensate, you can show that the profile of this Bose-Einstein condensate inside this cylinder is precisely the two-dimensional non-rotating Bessel star. And you add rotation by just moving this along the cylinder, along the phi coordinate, okay? Now you can perturb this profile. And it is clear why this profile is unstable at large L. And this is because any cylindrical configuration of a liquid or Bose-Einstein condensate, it is unstable because it wants to decrease its surface tension and form many spherical objects. And you can even estimate, actually calculate, okay? So if you write equations for perturbations, you can solve them analytically and calculate the number of spherical objects here and delta L. So number of spherical objects is of order of delta L, and it is of order of L. And this is the ratio of the size of the length of the ring divided by its width. Okay, so yeah, so this is not completely analytical, but all of this can be solved with Schrödinger method. So what you obtain is this. This is the lifetime of any Bose star. Actually, in the case of when the self-coupling is absent, this is the case that we considered, but you can generalize it easily. It is proportional to these parameters, but the proportionality coefficient, of course, it depends on the angular momentum of the Bose star. So the lifetime is proportional to angular momentum squared. And the angular momentum transfer is always of order of the angular momentum itself. So the particles basically go down almost to the ground level. And these graphs, they show the comparison between our analytics and numerics. You see a good comparison. So they show the dependence of the instability exponent, inverse lifetime on the angular momentum of Bose star. So the real question is whether these objects can live like forever. Forever for us is the lifetime of the universe, okay? So probably they are unstable, but they are stable enough to exist in the universe. And funnily enough, you can substitute mass equals to 10 to the minus 22 electron volt and find out that if Bose star mass is smaller than 10 to the 7 solar masses, then the lifetime actually is larger than this than lifetime of the universe. So probably these objects can rotate, okay, in our universe. But the problem is this. So precisely at these masses, at masses smaller than 10 to the 7 solar masses, the period of this configuration, namely the period with which these configurations oscillate, is larger than the lifetime of the universe. Okay, so in other words, if we multiply the lifetime of Bose star times the binding energy of particles inside this Bose star, this is the number of order one. And this means that you cannot just put the particles on the level with on the level omega s for a time shorter than this 1 over omega s. Before this time, these objects decay. So decay, the lifetime is smaller than the binding energy, inverse binding energy. This means that rotating Bose stars cannot be considered as quasi-stationary states. Basically, they do not exist physically. This slide shows the effect of self-interaction. Now we switch on the self-coupling, lambda 4, and this graph shows the self-coupling here in some units, and on the vertical axis we have an instability exponent, inverse lifetime. And we see, first of all, that our theorem is correct. If lambda 4 is 0 or smaller than 0, then this lifetime is this exponent is positive. So these objects are unstable, okay? They have a positive exponent. Now, if coupling is very small, smaller than some critical value, then the Bose stars do not even exist at a given mass, they collapse. So if you start with this lambda 4 and start with some donut form configuration and evolve it in time, you will not obtain decaying Bose star into the one non-rotating object. You will rather the axions will develop two regions where the density is huge, and they will start falling onto this region. This is the Poisson nova, okay? And the critical mass for the, so there is a critical coupling at a given mass, and conversely, there is a mass at a given coupling. So the critical mass at L equals to one is larger actually than the critical mass for non-rotating Bessel star. So rotating Bessel star indeed it is harder to, it is less subject to collapse than the non-rotating one. It is, it fights the against the collapse, but at the same time, so the suggestion in literature was correct, but at the same time, at larger couplings, okay, so at in this region of couplings, another rotational instability develops.
Dima, you have been talking for half an hour.
Okay, so I'm almost finishing. So in this vast region, even at positive couplings, at zero couplings and negative couplings, the instability develops with positive exponent. But if coupling is large and positive, so that large coupling, large positive coupling means repulsion. So if axions repulse with large force, then we have stability of this object. So the conditions for the stability are this, that the coupling should be large and positive, that this should be an elementary Bessel star with one vortex, and mass should be large enough at a given coupling, okay? And in a nutshell, this interaction picture looks like this, that if you have positive self-coupling repulsion, then this is a Bessel star. The red circle is a Bessel star, and the black ones are vortices. So this is like a laboratory Bessel-Einstein condensate with repulsive particles. In this case, the vortices also repulse from each other, and they also repulse from any region where psi equals to zero. So they repulse from the boundaries of the Bessel stars. And in this case, the configuration with one vortex, for example, is stable because this vortex, it repulses from all boundaries. And if attraction dominates, this is the opposite case when the vortices attract and they also attract to the vast region outside of the stars, because in this region also psi equals to zero. Yeah, so all vortices want to leave the Bessel star to the periphery of the system. And this is precisely the process where the axions go away and take away the angular momentum. So my conclusions. So we have shown that all rotating Bessel stars are unstable at negative or zero self-couplings. And this is a process showing that there are no actually rotating Bessel stars in the universe. And this can be used for observation. And this process, of course, is, it was considered a similar process in literature where relativistic rotating boson stars, which mimic black holes, it was shown that they also develop the same rotational instabilities, so they cannot mimic rotating black holes. Actually, we have shown that returning to our Bessel stars, we have shown that these decay fast, so they cannot be considered quasi-stationary. And this means, unfortunately, that we cannot stabilize until against Bessel nova without introducing additional rotating instabilities. And actually, on the positive side, there are models where you create black holes, some subpopulation of black holes from Bessel stars. So you create, so Joshua was talking about this a little bit. You create Bessel stars, you make them gravitationally collapse, they make a black holes. And our prediction is that these black holes should not have a non-zero spin. And when they coalesce, LIGO discovers gravity waves from these black holes, and they give you the spins of these black holes. And currently, they say that the spins of these black holes are super small, unexpectedly small. And probably the models where the Bessel stars collapse into the black holes, they can explain this feature. So I also should mention that we invented the analytic technique to describe fast rotating Bessel stars, and it can be used for other more complicated simulations situations like relativistic Bessel stars. So thanks for attention.
Yeah, thank you, Dima. Please, questions? Yes, Alexander?
Do you hear me? Dima, yeah. Do you hear me? It's very interesting.
Yeah.
But also, probably, I have three astrophysical questions. First, about formation. And second, about radio signal. You said about radio signal, but you did not describe, let us say, property of this signal. I mean, frequency range, expected at least, or wide range. And also property, I mean, let us say, light curve or time dependence of this signal. And also, you said that it may be useful for gravitational wave signal for, let us say, black holes with stellar masses. But what about mass ranges in principle? Could it be, for instance, like 10 to the 5 solar masses, which is suitable for LIGO, for LISA, because if you have some sources, powerful sources.
So let me answer in order. Yeah, so let me answer one by another. Okay, so there are many dark matter models, because the mass of dark matter particles is basically a free parameter. So you can consider QCD axions. In this case, we are talking about Bessel stars which have like 10 to the minus 13 or 10 to the minus 15 solar masses, sometimes 10 to the minus 10 solar masses. And if you use these parameters, you will discover that the critical mass at which they collapse or radio explode, it is like 10 to the minus 10 solar masses or 10 to the minus 11 solar masses. And they radio explode, and they mostly emit radio waves at a frequency equal to the axion mass, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Half actually of the axion mass, doesn't matter. Half of the axion mass, and for this mass of order of 10 to the minus 5 eV, this is precisely something like 7 gigahertz. Okay. Now, how can they radio expand? What are they? It also depends on models. Collapse and then radio explode, then this is a very transient signal, very similar to fast radio burst. The only feature that, their energy is 10 to the 40 of order of fast radio burst. Their duration can be, can be arbitrary, depends on the parameter, but it can be made 1 millisecond. But the only difference is that they mostly, their frequency mostly equals to the gigahertz scale. Now, if you consider drastically different masses of particle, you will get drastically different masses of Bessel stars. And these masses tend to the 8 solar masses, they are closer to the black holes. So if you take mass of particle a bit larger than this, a bit larger than 10 to the minus 22, you can actually play with models where they collapse and create a supermassive black hole in the center of galaxy.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Dima. Xavier?
Hi, Dima. I had a question, two questions actually. The first is whether you were you able to calculate or estimate pseudo-analytically what is the dependence on the critical mass for Bessel stars with the negative self-interaction as a function of the angular moment? You have the large L analytics.
The question is, can we? Of course we can. Okay, so But we didn't do it. We calculated the critical mass for angular momentum equals to one only. And it is given by this formula. And this number, it should depend on L. Okay, so it should be larger at larger L. So it should be proportional to something like L to some power. I can say which. It is possible and possible easily with our technique. Unfortunately, so this is a good question for future work. Very good.
But so another question is, would it make sense, or these things are so unstable, as you said, that the lifetime is smaller?
It doesn't make much sense, because even if at smaller masses, okay, these objects are unstable with respect to different instability. And my argument why they're so unstable that you shouldn't take this into account is this, that you have these objects and they have a binding energy of particles, and you cannot trust your particles to occupy a given level with binding energy omega s if at time scales smaller than omega s to the minus one. But the whole composite object actually decays at time scales of order of inverse binding energy. So you can prepare this object staying with you for some time, but certainly not from generic data, certainly with huge fine tuning, and it will not stay for a long time. So for it will oscillate a couple of times and it will decay.
Okay, other questions, please? Other questions? Well, may I also ask a question, even though the time is running late? Dima, does one expect binaries of these Bose stars? And what will happen when the binary coalesces?
We have bound binaries, right? So for example, if we prepare one rotating Bose star, it forms exactly the binary of the Bose stars. Of two Bose stars, but actually the binaries they do rotate. They have orbital. They orbit around each other, and this already is enough to destroy them with tidal forces. What happens in this movie is that first you form a binary, and then the tidal forces destroy the binary. Actually, Jens Niemeyer with collaborators was studying exactly this process when the Bose star orbits some gravitational center, and it is destroyed by these tidal forces. If you have a fast rotating Bose star, it's like a thin ring, right? And it decays into many small Bose stars. It should decay into many small Bose stars, which go right one after another, like in a dance, okay, in a circle dance, okay. And I expect that most of them will be destroyed. Unfortunately, they will not form this motion forever.
When you form the Bose stars, I can hardly imagine you form a ring like that, but I can imagine easily that you form a binary of two stars just orbiting one another. What will happen next?
One of the stars will be tidally disrupted, or both.
To nothing.
Yeah, to the debris, to the waves of dark matter, to particles.
What happens to energy?
One of the stars will be tidally disrupted. All the particles will stay orbiting, okay? They will carry energy, they will carry angular momentum. And another star appears in the center, and there is a cloud of diffuse axions, and they rotate around it. So basically, the two of them rotate around the center of mass.
Okay, thanks. I think we can discuss the further details in
private. The end product is a Bose star with zero angular momentum.
This I got, but what happens to what flies away? Okay, anyway, so thanks again, Dima.